Today, I am honored and privileged to introduce to you Dr. Susan Estep, a founding member and past president of the American Academy for Oral and Systemic Health and a distinguished member of our advisory council. Dr. Estep is a cosmetic dentist and founder of InTown Smile Studio in Atlanta, Georgia. She has spent her career perfecting her skills in both cosmetic dentistry and facial aesthetics. Today, she will be presenting incorporating three oral and systemic principles into general dentistry practice, elevate your team, your practice reputation, and your bottom line. If you have any questions, please ask them in the Q&A section of the chat, and we will do our best to answer as many as possible at the end of the presentation. So without further ado, I present to you Dr. Susan Estep.
Violet, thank you so much. And thank you, Danielle and Trish, for being here today. And thank you for the invitation to join you guys today. Again, on my disclosure or non-disclosure, I am a full-time general dentist. I'm not a professional speaker. So I do this in my practice every day. And I'm hoping to share a few pearls that will help you elevate your patient outcomes, your team, and your practice profitability. So my practice is called InTown Smile Studio, and we are right here in the middle of downtown or midtown Atlanta, Georgia. So in Atlanta, fun facts, we're known for our traffic. Okay, not the greatest thing, but we're also known for being a very green city with trees everywhere. People are always surprised when they fly into this major metropolitan area and they don't see a concrete jungle. Instead, they see all green. Our weather is pretty fantastic. It gets too hot for a few weeks in the summer, and it gets too cold for a few weeks in the winter, and we can play outside almost all year round. So here is the front door of my practice. We're on the retail level under a condo building, and it's a small space, but we built an aesthetically pleasing practice with 7 operatories. Outside of dentistry, I find my joy and spend my time with my family. That includes a couple of fur babies and a couple of human babies who I blinked and they became 16 and 17 and a junior and senior in high school. And our family is growing. This is Brian and 2 of his 4 kids with my 2 and me earlier this year in Paris, where he put this on my finger. And I truly count my blessings to have such joy outside of the joy of dentistry. So back to dentistry. For our roadmap this afternoon, we'll have some brief science review. I'll discuss the verbiage and patient communication that we use routinely in our practice every day, as well as some tools and therapies that we use with our patients. And I'll illustrate how incorporating these can lead to wins, specifically improving patient outcomes, elevating our team, and increasing practice profitability. So how did I get here? So my journey from being a dentist into having an oral and systemic practice, of course, started in dental school, where I thought that this dentiform and these 32 teeth and one day a human and their 32 teeth was going to be my entire world. And freshman year in dental school, our anatomy professor, Dr. Shirawi, constantly said to us, "You will not be tooth carpenters. You are going to be physicians of the masticatory system." And as my mindset changed to being a physician of the masticatory system, I realized that TMJ and occlusion were going to play an important role in my practice. So after dental school, I attended the best continuums I could find, including the Dawson Academy and Frank Spear and John Coyce's continuums. I had the honor of sitting next to Dr. Pete Dawson before he went to heaven, and I highly recommend his book called A Better Way. It's a great read, and it motivates me to be a better dentist and a better human. So early in my career, I was motivated to be the highest quality dentist I could possibly be, and I was proud that I could deliver comprehensive, full mouth, predictable, high quality dentistry for my patients. And in 2008, I was assaulted by the oral and systemic connections. And by assault, I mean assault. One of my favorite academies had their annual scientific conference, and the whole weekend they showed science about how unhealthy things in your mouth can adversely and severely affect your total health. During that conference, my team and I went out to dinner, and we were like, "Y'all, the mouth is connected to the body." Soon after that, Dr. Chris Kammer reached out to a group of us because he realized that we needed to have a dental academy dedicated to this science. And of course, we all know that's how AAOSH was born. So who are these oral terrorists? Well, we all knew how to spell and pronounce them in school, and now we just dumb them down to AA, PG, TD, TF, and FN. We'll take a deeper dive on them in a minute. But this is what I was like when I left that conference. It's not like I could unlearn the science that had just been revealed to me. I felt my responsibility to my patients was now even more elevated. And at the same time, I'm not a physician, and I don't have a deep knowledge about the medical side of these oral and systemic connections. I was overwhelmed because I felt like I now needed to go to medical school to understand all this stuff. It was hard for me to figure out where to start. So to simplify it in my mind, I narrowed it down. What is a common denominator in nearly all of these oral and systemic connections? Well, we can start with inflammation. You'll see this slide in a lot of AAOSH presentations because this Time magazine story was published in 2004, literally 20 years ago. So for 20 years, we have known that chronic systemic inflammation is the root cause of a lot of medical diseases. The general population, aka our patients, know and understand this fact. Inflammation in the mouth leads to chronic systemic inflammation. So this was an easy place for me to start. If I could find the inflammation in the mouth, I could have a conversation about health. Now, who in our practices can spot inflammation better than anyone else? Hopefully our hygienist participants are grinning big right now. And if you don't already know about the hygienist superhero, by the end of this hour, I hope it will be quite obvious. You see, our hygienists are on the front lines with our patients. They spend the time. They are usually the first ones to see the signs of inflammation. They earn their capes and crowns and dental mirror wands every day. Here is a place where inflammation reveals itself every day in our practice. A dear AAOSH colleague, Dr. Bill Dom, started ZT4BG in his practice decades ago. He had t-shirts printed and business cards that were placed in all the patients' goodie bags. So if you're just getting started with this in your practice, a good place to start is to say, no more bloody prophies, zero tolerance for bleeding gums. This prophy cup is not going to reduce inflammation. So when there's inflammation, that opens up the door for us to have a conversation. So let's focus a minute about inflammation and heart attack and stroke. Heart disease is still the leading cause of death for all men and women in the US, and it has been since 1921, for 100 years. Today, a person in the US dies every 33 seconds from cardiovascular disease. 109 people will die in the US during this webinar. And what is the root cause of heart disease? Chronic systemic inflammation. I'm sure you've heard Brad Bale and Amy Donine speak about this. They understand heart disease inside and out, and they wrote this book for us and our patients to shout from the rooftops that heart attacks and strokes are preventable. What? Preventable? For over 100 years, the leading cause of death for our men and women is preventable? How is that possible? Because they're looking for root causes, specifically the root cause for inflammation. In this cartoon, the arteries are the fruits of this tree. And from left to right, you go from a healthy artery to an artery that's about to have a heart attack or stroke. And if you look at the trunk of the tree, it's inflammation that's causing the arteries to go from healthy to heart attack. And if you look below the trunk, you can see all of the potential root causes for the inflammation. So can we do anything? Can we do something about all of these causes for our patients? No, not all of them, but look more closely. What about here and here? Periodontal disease and endodontic disease are root causes for chronic systemic inflammation that leads to cardiac and stroke. But why? So in Finding a Better Way, one of Pete Dawson's mantras was to keep asking why and keep asking why until you can't ask why any longer. So why are periodontal and endodontic disease root causes for inflammation when it comes to causing heart attack and stroke? Well, to better understand this, we have to understand what a cardiovascular event looks like. This is an artery that's cut in half, and on the left, it's healthy, and on the right, it's a heart attack or a stroke. In health, on the left side, the inside lining of the artery is strong and intact. It's impenetrable to harmful particles. It only allows proper nutrients to pass through to the inside of the wall. In the presence of inflammation, this junction starts to get leaky. And the tight junctions that hold the cells together start to loosen, and this creates an opportunity for junk to get into the wall of the artery. Once the junk piles up, soft plaque begins to form in the wall of the artery. The wall gets thicker and thicker, the soft plaque grows and grows, and kind of like a pimple, until it pops through the surface. And now, just like when a pimple pops on your face, your body sends platelets to scab or plug or clot the opening. And that clot fills up the inside of the artery and stops blood flow, which stops oxygen flow. And if that artery is in the heart, it's a heart attack. And if that artery is in the brain, it's a stroke. So where do periodontal and endodontic disease play a role here? Well, these periodontal pathogens turn on chronic systemic inflammation, which makes the inside lining of the artery leaky. And now these bacteria can get into the wall of the artery, and they start to promote the growth of these plaques. And that is how they're involved in heart attack and stroke. Some science behind that, we have solid science. In 2016, Bale and Donin published this science: high-risk periodontal pathogens contribute to the pathogenesis of atherosclerosis. So they show level A evidence, which is causative, that these five periodontal pathogens, AA, PG, TD, TF, and FN, increase risk for heart attack and stroke. They travel in the bloodstream from the periodontal tissues, and they cause damage to the interior lining of the arteries and help set up the scenario for heart attack or stroke. Also in 2013, this article was published. There were 101 patients having a heart attack, and surgeons biopsied the thrombus or clot that caused the heart attack. And in 78% of the thrombi, they found bacterial DNA from endodontic infection. And in 35%, they found periodontal pathogens. Then they went back to the dentists of these patients to try to find panoramic x-rays. And of the pans that they were able to gather, nearly half of them, there was a periapical radiolucency present in their pan before they had an event. So does this science change how we react when we see this? What about this? It's asymptomatic. Anyone remember when we called it just a scar? I don't know about you, but when I see these, I get sweaty pits. What about this one? Am I even seeing something there? Well, to be honest, I did note it at his checkup, but I didn't make a big deal out of it. Well, earlier this year, it started bothering him, so I sent him to endo for eval and this. So what do we do with these when we see them and they're asymptomatic? Let's go back to rhyme time. These are all signs of inflammation. And when there's inflammation, we gotta have a conversation. I kid you not, this new patient came in yesterday. When he came in, he had no dental concerns. He was referred by a periodontist who he'd been seeing for years, who he wanted to have a general dentist to see that part of the year, but had no dental concerns whatsoever, nothing significant. But let's look at his medical history. Last year, he had surgery for erectile dysfunction, which is a vascular problem that also is indicative of low nitric oxide levels. And he had a cardioversion, which uses low energy shocks to restore a regular heart rhythm. He sees a cardiologist. His meds are atorvastatin, so a statin, Eliquis, which is a blood thinner, olmesartan medoxamil, which is for hypertension. And these eye drops are for ocular hypertension. How about his health history? Heart problems, cardiac stent, high blood pressure, taking statin drugs. And his family medical history: heart disease, heart attack, stroke. And he's just here for a cleaning. So what do I say to this guy when he's been going to the dentist multiple times a year and given a clean bill of dental health? Okay, we raced through some science, and now we can translate that in. How are we going to translate that into our practice setting? So how are we going to have a meaningful and fruitful conversation with our patient? How do we broach that conversation? What does it sound like? So if you have the ability in your office to take this photo, that's a really good first step. Show your patient this photo and then look at the medical history and family medical history. If anything is related to cardiovascular disease, you can say, hey, you have a lot of inflammation going on and that concerns me. Did you know that inflammation in your gums could increase your risk for heart attack and stroke? And I noticed in your health history that you're on blood pressure medication, a statin, you have a family history. I'm concerned that if you can't eliminate the inflammation, it could seriously hurt your total health.